Hi, I'm Sunniej, and we're here at Sunniej Live, where we're going to talk about the ups, the downs, the ins and outs, the crazy turnabouts, the slips, the trips, the stumbles, and the falls, but most importantly, the get back ups as we together engage in this thing called life. And today I have a celebrity chef. Yay! We all like to eat, right? Good stuff. So I have Chef Juvon. So welcome, Chef. How are you?
Thank you. I'm blessed and highly favored. How about yourself?
Hey, I can't complain. You're here.
Yes.
Yay!
Yes!
We're here.
Yes!
If we're not excited about being here, we're in trouble. Every day is an opportunity. I know that's right. As long as I'm on the other side of the dirt, I'm good. So, what does that mean when we say celebrity chef?
I'm glad you asked, because a lot of people who ask that, you see it in Facebook and some threads. My mentee asked the other day. So, there are two different definitions. There are two different categories, I would say. There's one chef that cooks for celebrities primarily, or there is a chef who cooks on TV that makes him a celebrity. I happen to fall in both categories.
Okay.
So there's no argument whether I'm a celebrity chef or not. So nobody can say I'm not a celebrity chef. No one can say that.
Right. Okay, so you cook on TV?
I have.
Okay. All right. That's interesting. Now, you know, it's funny. Off camera, I said to you, what's your favorite thing to cook? And what did you tell me?
I don't have a favorite thing. I mean, I love to cook seafood, but I mean, to be honest, when it all boils down, I don't have a favorite thing to cook, because I cook all the time.
Yeah, because that's your life.
That's
right?
It.
Right? So, now, how did you become a chef? Like, because that's not where your life started.
No. So, it's always been a passion. You know, the first thing you'll see in my bio on my website is that, you know, as a kid, looking at grandma in the kitchen, smelling those onions and as it caramelizes and that garlic just smelling, it was like, Lord have mercy, what's she cooking? But it was just the onions and the garlic. But then it was the sound of the sizzling. It was like music to my ears, like hearing that bacon sizzle in the pan. It was like, oh, it was like music. I was like, I want to get in there. I want to do what she's doing. But that was just a passion. It was just a passion at that point.
Right. Now, but you didn't start even as a chef.
You were. Well, you want me diving?
You were something in the.
You want me diving?
Yeah, just go ahead. Let's go ahead and dive.
She's like, come on, chef, give it to us. I started out. Well, I mean, you know, actually, like I said, it was just a passion. I went to military school, and my trade was culinary. I didn't know that was going to be a trade. I was just there. Uh-huh. I would get a diploma. It was a great program. But anyway, became my trade. And I ended up with kidney failure.
Wow.
At a very early age, like 19, 20 years old, if I can recall. And being on dialysis for 5 long years. Long years. It's not, you know, when I paint the picture of being on dialysis, I don't want to paint the picture as, okay, I'm going to get my therapy, my treatment, I go home, I'll go to work. No, this is a whole nother life. This is a whole other life where this is you. This is you, part of your life where you go every other day for 3.5 hours
wow.
to more hours on the machine, depending on your treatment. And this is your life. If you want to travel, you got to schedule your treatment ahead of time if they have slots open. This is your life. Watching people die on the machine.
Really?
Because it takes a toll on
wow.
your heart. So it's a whole other life. When I first embarked into this, I saw a lot of older people on dialysis.
Right.
I'm at a young age. I'm like, what is this? What's I don't know what dialysis is. I don't know what kidney failure is. I don't even know what my kidneys do. You know, you know what I'm saying? I don't know what they do. They just back there. I didn't even know they were back there. They could have been here. But anyway, it's a whole other life. And so to see people die on this machine, literally cardiac arrest, what is going on?
Right.
I had to find God.
Wow. Yeah. Well, that would do it for you. Now, how did you even find that you had a kidney problem? Like, how did that even happen?
The worst way possible. I was living with the symptoms at its worst stage. That's what the doctor said. It was they called it end-stage renal disease. And I was living with the illness, working at American Girl, walking around so much, waking up with feeling fatigued, sweating. I couldn't even stand and brush my teeth.
Wow.
You know, I was just sweating. I couldn't even stand up. My feet were so swollen. I didn't know what the heck that was.
Right.
I couldn't barely put my shoes in. Every time I go to work, I would throw up in the train station blood. at the same stop, at the same hallway, every morning I would throw up blood. And so, okay, I think I got the flu. All right, I'm gonna eat my oatmeal, drink my orange juice, start taking some vitamins. I'm gonna take care of myself. But in all actuality, I was killing myself because one that's on dialysis can't drink orange juice, can't eat oatmeal, can't eat bananas. I was killing myself more, right?
Stuff. Oh, wow.
So the end stage, I was living with the end stage disease and didn't know it. And so one day, my feet were so swollen, I was tired. It was like a week before Christmas or 2 weeks before. It was very busy. American girl, very busy place. I said, I gotta go to the emergency room. Told my supervisor, gotta go to the emergency room. I went to the emergency room, Elmhurst Hospital in Queens, New York, and it was that night they diagnosed me with end-stage renal disease. I said, all right, patch me up, give me a band-aid, give me my medication, let's go. They said, no, sir, it's not, we're gonna keep you. We're gonna do emergency dialysis tonight. We'll put a tube in your neck and do dialysis. So I'm like, what? Okay, it didn't hit me until I had that first treatment. My body got cold, my body got hot, I was shaking, I was sweating. It went through a whole chemical process where your blood is leaving your body to be dialyzed, to be cleaned by this artificial kidney.
Right.
I was scared. I'm like, what is this? That's a whole book right there.
Wow. And you know, that's interesting because I never even gave it a thought. I mean, I know that it, like you said, I know what dialysis, quote unquote, looks like, but never think what it really feels like, or what that, how it takes over your life, your time. That is your life.
That's 5 years.
So 5 years. Wow. And so after that 5 years, now, did you have a transplant?
I had a transplant. Still have it. I want to add some more color to the pink canvas, if you don't mind.
No, go
just
ahead.
Add some gold trim into it. Being on dialysis doesn't mean you're going to get a kidney. Doesn't mean you're going to get a transplant. It's like a report card. You have to take care of yourself. You have to make your treatment. You have to not cut your time, because a lot of people cut their time to go on vacation, go to the beach, or something like that. No, your blood results have to look good. You have to eat right. And so if the doctors feel you're worthy enough to get the kidney, you will get it.
Oh.
It's not about being at the top of the transplant list. It's not about if your blood is just right. Everything collectively has to be right. So going through this, being on the transplant list for 5 years, getting a call, hey, we think we have a kidney for you. Yes, oh my God, yeah, we're on our way. Sorry, the kidney wasn't the right match for you. Another year later, oh, we think we got a kidney. Oh, yes, oh my God, we're about to go get this transplant. Sorry, it wasn't the right one for you. It's like giving a basket of kidney candy to a kid and saying, no, you can't eat it yet.
Yeah.
5 years.
That's a long time.
Yeah. And then I get a transplant. Thank God.
Then you got the transplant.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
And then you got the transplant. Now, so that was that kind of like a smooth sailing kind of situation, or was that a whole nother?
It was the same thing. No hype. There was no hype. I didn't get excited. I'm like, okay. They said I need to be down at the emergency room now. I didn't get there at 8 a.m., but no, 6 a.m. I did 100 on the highway. I prayed. There was no troopers on the highway. I speeded all the way there. I got there. And got there, they started the surgery at 8 a.m. I feel like I'm forgetting something. They did call me. I didn't think it was going to happen. You know what I mean? So I didn't get excited. But then when they said, where are you? You need to get down here. That's when I started doing flips in the house. And I didn't know I could flip it. I didn't know I could do flips. But that's when I did flips. And so I got down to the hospital, got the transplant, and it was a whole new life. We call it the gift of life.
Yeah. Because no more having to
dialysis,
number of times a week, and
I'm
going to
work now. So, let me just add, dialysis, multiple ways of doing dialysis. You have hemodialysis, you have peritoneal dialysis. I did hemodialysis, which is more safe. The needles that you get when you do dialysis, that's what this scar is about.
Oh, wow.
The needles are the biggest needles in the industry. 15-gauge, 16-gauge needles. The smaller the number is, the bigger the bevel. The bevel is the hole of the needle.
Right.
When they put those needles in, you see the scar?
Uh-huh.
When they put those... Let me get your hand real quick. When they put those needles in, it's like a blowtorch blowing on your arm.
Wow.
The sucker hurts.
Wow.
I'm going to say something else, but the sucker hurt.
That's crazy.
Do you feel that?
Yeah.
That's my axis.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's your what?
That's what you call the axis.
Oh. It's like pumps, like.
Yeah, that's the artery in the vein put together to create a stronger blood flow.
Yeah, it's like a whole, like.
Yeah, yeah. And you can hear it. It sounds like a sonogram. So
that's
they create
crazy.
This so that the blood can flow throughout your body into the machine, because if they hook you up, your vein would collapse. It wouldn't even work.
Right, so they have to...
Yeah, but you have some good veins, though.
Well, thank you.
That's the medical side kicking in right there.
Wow, but that's, I mean, who knew? I never knew that. Mm-hmm. So this is very educational. I mean, no one wants to go through this.
I'm pretty for my worst enemy.
However, we got to take care of ourselves. So even though your body was telling you, listen, something's wrong here. This is a Juvon thing. I got the flu. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Because, you know.
They go to the hospital. I was in denial.
And then when you finally went, it's because it was just had gotten to the point, like, something's wrong. I got to get something. Still thinking, just give me something. I should be good.
Yes.
And that's what we do, right? And luckily, you got there in time. You finally went.
They said that I could have died anywhere between now and then. They say you was too much toxin was in your body. I mean, I forgot to mention the awful smell that was coming out of my mouth. Dead. There was something dead in me.
Right.
It was hard. Nothing's... But here's the twist. Here's where God gets the glory.
Okay.
I had a transplant, right? Mm-hmm. And after you get a transplant, they say you have to take medications for the rest of your life so that your body doesn't reject the organ.
Right.
I'm not on any medications. For the past 6 years, medication free.
Wow.
Ain't nobody else but him.
Absolutely.
Hey!
There you go. God gets the glory. So obviously you've been going to the doctors and they're testing you. Yes. And they're like, no, you're good.
You're good. Doctors refuse to believe it. Doctors say, well, we still think you should go see a nephrologist to get on some medication just in case. Just in case what?
Just what? Yeah. Just in case you want me to have a side effect of something else. That's what you want to
see? Because I didn't get money, the industry? No. When God healed the blind, that was it. When he healed the cripple, that was it. When he healed the man from leprosy, that was it.
That was it.
He didn't have to take medications just in case.
That's right. I know. Listen, this is going to get crazier. I just want to tell you, but it's going to be a lot of fun, and you're going to learn a lot because I've learned a lot already so far. So you stay tuned. We'll be right back.
K-Y, come on. Come on.
Welcome back to Sunniej Live. I'm having such a great time with Chef Juvon and his stories. And, you know, that whole kidney thing, that, you know, it's just amazing what we don't know. Like, mm-hmm. I'm sure you learned so much about the human body after going through that, right? Yes,
absolutely. You had to, you know, at first, you know, like I said in the beginning, I didn't know what kidneys do. I didn't know where the kidneys were located. I didn't know how important the kidneys are to the body. I didn't know how God was so... the way he structured the body, he's such an engineer. When you talk about engineering, the way he structured the body, this goes to this and this connects to this and this plumps, and I'm like, it's very intricate, but I didn't know the kidneys were the top three organs you need to live.
Do you drink a lot of water?
I do. I travel with water.
Yeah, right.
Water's my best friend now.
I know that's right. So you got the transplant, and then what happened? You decided to go into the medical field because of that, or?
Yeah, so sitting there watching the nurses and techs and take care of you, I was like, I can do this. So I'm what you call a problem patient. That's what centers don't like. They don't like problem patients. Problem patient is one that speaks up for themselves or speak up for other patients as well. You don't allow no stuff to happen to other patients or to yourself. So right. I was a problem patient, and you know, I had the health department on speed dial. You know, things weren't right, you know, because on the other side of the business, it's a business.
It's a business, absolutely.
It's a job to some of them, it's a paycheck to some of them.
Right, they don't really care.
Right, hello. And so I said, I can do this. I wanted to get into the medical field, and lo and behold, like, I excelled in the medical field than I ever did in regular school, college, and high school. I did much better.
Right.
Yeah.
because you saw that there was a need.
Yes.
And how valuable it is to have good medical care,
yes.
people that care.
Yes, absolutely.
Actually show that they care. So mm-hmm. then you was in the medical field for a while, and then what made you leave that?
Well, working in the emergency room, I love the emergency room. The adrenaline and people dying, is the need of saving lives and educating people as well. Mm-hmm. Walking as a testimony, I love telling people what I went through, and they'd be like, what? But I was getting physically tired.
Okay.
Physically tired. I love taking care of people. I'm a servant at heart. And so what I do now is I'm still a servant at heart, just a different aspect, right? So when I moved here to Florida from New York City, Mount Sinai Hospital is where I used to work at. Worked at Florida Hospital, now is Advent Health.
Right.
And I was like, I feel like a slave here. I don't feel like I'm actually making a difference.
Mm-hmm.
And so I prayed to God. I was like, God, if you can release me from this job, and I want to cook more. I want to cook full time.
Right.
And so somebody posted a job ad on Facebook, or Chef Freddy does his name, and thank you, shout out to Freddy. And before I got the job, I walked down there, and I'm dressed with my chef coat on, ready to work. I don't go to interviews in suits. I go to interviews ready to work.
Right.
They hire you the same day, you can work.
I can show you what I can do.
Right, exactly. Right. And so I went down in this nice big... French chef is intimidating, and he's interviewing me, and I tell him, listen, I never worked in the hotel restaurant business, but this is what I can do. I showed him pictures, and he hired me. And I was like a sponge. I was like, I want to learn. Told the chefs at meetings, I want to learn more. I want to do more. I don't want to work the line and do this and that and the same thing every day. It's the same thing every day. So they put me upstairs at banquets with Chef Freddy, shout out to him. And I got to do me, you know, recipes and learn more. And that's where I defined myself and what type of chef I wanted to be at the Grand Bohemian Hotel.
Wow. That's a nice place to start.
Yes. Very nice place to start.
Yeah. And so now you were there for what, about 3 years?
I was at the Grand for 2 years, I want to say. Pandemic happened. But right before the pandemic happened, I prayed. Business was picking up. Business was picking up.
Because you were doing what? Catering? What were you doing?
Personal chef. Dinners,
okay.
Brunches. More
okay.
dinners than anything.
Okay.
And the Prophet family hired me. He's a retired NBA player. And he hired me. But it was a struggle at first, because I told him, I said, listen, I work in a hotel business. I can't call out on Valentine's Day. You know, that's the holiday of the business, the holidays.
Right.
But he said, it wasn't me. I said to him first, I said, I'm praying about it. And he said, Chef, it's going to happen for you this year. I said, well, you know what? Just because you're speaking like that, I didn't know his faith or nothing like that. And just because he's speaking like that, he's speaking into the atmosphere, I'm going to do it for you. Him and his wife, Alicia, a very known lawyer here in Orlando.
Uh-huh.
Worked for them. I did the dinner. I called out, but I told them I was responsible. I said, I'm going to call out. I can't show up. No, it's not for my own personal business. Yes, I lied. But the chef knew. He knew what I was doing. Everybody knew I was a personal chef on the side.
Right.
And I would want to be responsible and tell them, I'm going to call out for Valentine's Day so you can fill that slot.
Right.
So I don't leave everybody hanging.
Yeah.
Right. And they didn't deny it. They denied it. Of course, they hired somebody else. And from then on, I was praying, God, release me from this job because my business is picking up. I said, May has to be the last month, May. Maybe he misheard, he heard the M. In March, when the pandemic happened, I got laid off. And I was like, okay, Lord, I thank you, I praise you. And I started my own business, and it's been a success ever since then.
No looking back, right?
No looking back.
Okay. So what does a normal day or week look like for you?
Cool.
Are you working for like a one set of clients that kind of rotates around, or
What's funny that you asked that, because when I first thought about the personal chef industry, I thought it would be like, what kind of industry is it? Are people really hiring chefs that many times that much?
Right.
So when I first started, yes, I was working for particular people for different events. Okay, girls' night and Thanksgiving's coming up, you know, stuff like that.
Right.
But the industry, I guess we thank the pandemic for it. Restaurants were closed. People
right.
still don't want to celebrate. They want to eat.
Right.
They want to have these big lavish
and
parties.
They're not going to cook it.
They're not cooking it. And so I was... Oh my God, my calendar was booked up. I was like, and so I started hiring servers. I started hiring other chefs,
right.
other cooks, even people that I got laid off with from the Grand Bohemian. I started hiring them. We can all do this. There's more fish in the sea for us to eat.
Right.
There's enough for us to eat, you know,
right.
especially big as Florida is.
Right.
So to answer your question, man, there's people traveling to Florida all the time.
Right.
That's what keeps me busy. People always celebrating something. Right. They got Airbnbs down here. Right.
And that's a huge market.
Hello! That's something else I'm going to get into right there. But I think that's what... I can't imagine me doing this in New York. You know how many churches there is on every corner in New York? There's like 5 churches on one corner in New York City. That's the same ratio as when it comes to shops in New York City. New York City is so small. And so I thank God for him moving me out here, because if it was my choice, I wouldn't have moved out here. Me and he don't get along. We fight.
No.
I get tired, but we fight. So thank God I'm in Florida. The business is blooming here. Airbnbs, people always traveling down here for something, and they want a shop.
Absolutely. Wow. and that's the thing that, you know, the pandemic really boosted some industry. A lot of industries really grew very large during the pandemic. And some things died, but it made shifts. Mm-hmm. I should say that. It shifted things,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And on that note, we'll be right back.
Hi, have a TV show idea, but don't know how to get started? Reach out to me at glstvnetwork.com@gmail.com. Again, that's glstvnetwork.com@gmail.com. And we'll help you find your voice.
And we're back with Sunniej Live and Chef Juvon. Now, you would never know or think that this person over here went through dialysis, had a kidney transplant, because he is just so full of energy.
Yes, yes.
Is that, I mean, like, where's all his energy come from?
I'll be honest with you, the excitement is within me, because I love serving people. I'm not like the type of chef, but most chefs are not people person. That was one of the things that other jobs tried to do to me, was tame me and like put a lion in a cage. And so I have all this energy in me. I just want to serve. Yes! Okay. I had to get that out.
And we don't want you running around the room.
No, we ain't going to do that. But I have this energy. I love serving people. I like to make people laugh and smile. You know, my mother tell you, I was always that type of child that was a people pleaser. I always want to please people. So I'm not one of those chefs that just wants to hang out in the kitchen and cook and do his thing. I love entertaining my guests, and that's why I tell people, we don't sell food. We don't have the best price. We do not have the best price. You have to live in one of my rules. We do not have the best price in town. If you got an estimate from someone else, please take that. We don't sell food. We sell an experience.
All right, I like that.
We like to become a part of people's archives. People remember us. People remember those shrimp and grits, because I don't make regular grits. You know, that's our signature dish, jerk shrimp and lobster bisque grits. You got to try it.
Oh, yeah, that sounds good.
You got to try. I should have wore some down. But,
right?
But that's where all the energy comes from. I just love pleasing people.
That's wonderful. But, you know, that's what makes you different.
Yes.
That's why, you know, the clients that you have.
Yes.
I'm sure you have repeat clients. Oh,
yes.
Referrals.
Yes.
Because it is about a different kind of experience.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And you're right. Chefs kind of just do their own thing quietly, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Plating,
right,
you know,
right.
I don't think I've ever met a chef like you. I don't think I have ever met a chef
very
like
entertaining.
You. Now, have you ever thought about wanting your own restaurant?
It is a thought, but I don't want one.
So, yeah, it's a thought, but no.
I don't want my own restaurant. What I would like is my own location for catering services, which means I'll build out the location to a kitchen. People can come taste, but it will be a built-out kitchen for catering, not restaurant. Not sitting, dining, stuff like that.
Right, right.
But I don't place limitations on God. If that's what God has for me and my endeavors, I receive it in the name of Jesus.
Okay. But, you know, it would be interesting, though, like what you said, if you had, like, a catering kitchen and people could come, you know, taste what they want and then put in their orders for what I'm going to have. Now, in that, just thinking through this. So if it's a catering kitchen, can they place an order and come and actually get food to take with them? Or would it be more like a taste?
Just a tasting for an event. It has to be scheduled.
And having it scheduled. Yeah. We're going to fix food for an event.
Right.
Okay,
it's not open to the public.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be interesting, right? But what's very interesting, like he said, I'm not the cheapest. So don't think that.
I do not have the best price.
I do not, but you have great food.
Yes.
Great food. Yes. Great experience.
Yes. That I can guarantee you will have a great experience. Very much. And I've done it for all ages. Little kids, adults, teenagers, I've done it. And everyone has a grand experience.
Right. What was your favorite event you could think of that you've done? That you really just had a blast with?
I can think of a few. Like, some of the events turns into a party afterwards. I don't want to say any names because, you know, right. I want other clients think they not better than others. But, well, one client flew me out to California. I can say no names. That was, like, the best right there experience. So we do travel. To say that, we do travel.
Right.
But most times, like, certain clients, it turns into a party afterwards. Staff clean up the kitchen, they're throwing, you know, bobble with it or, you know, step side to side, you know, and it just turns into a party. And I party with them.
Right.
We don't stay all night, we don't drink, we don't get in the pool, nothing like that.
Right.
We still keep professional.
Right.
But we still party with you.
Right. So you get a personal experience, you get to build a relationship.
Yes.
You know, and I think that's so important.
Yes.
That is so important.
We're very relatable.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would say that. So with all that you went through, mm-hmm. right, with the dialysis and the transplant, going into the medical field because you wanted to help, but you loved cooking, because that memory is from, you know, like you said, I've never heard anybody in my life talk about the sound of the bacon and the sound, and you were so, I mean, that, I think everybody felt that, you know,
yeah,
like, oh, probably. Wow, and I think we got hungry, actually, because I'm like, yeah.
I think you see it.
Yeah, I can see it.
See caramelization.
Yes. So, with all of that, how has that affected you health-wise? Are you more conscious of what you do? Do you actually talk to people more about that?
Yeah, that's a great question. You would think that I'm more health-conscious. I am somewhat. I love eating my vegetables. I have a special dish that I created for people on dialysis, which is sauteed collard greens with beige strawberries.
Wow, that sounds good.
It's very delectable, but there's a reason why I put it together. But I guess, yeah, to answer your question, I am more conscious. I don't eat much beef. I try to eat the minimal beef once a month. Actually, the maximum once a month.
Right. You eat a lot of chicken, a lot of fish?
I eat a lot more chicken, fish, lamb.
Okay.
But my vegetables, I love my vegetables. Love my vegetables.
Right. Yes. So you've actually created dishes?
Yes.
For people that are on dialysis?
Yes.
Do you have a cookbook for them?
Not as of yet. Those are in the works. This one dish I created with the collard greens and sauteed strawberries, I created that because when they told me I couldn't have collard greens and Christmas was right around the corner, I was like, the devil is alive. How am I not going to have collard greens for the Christmas dinner? What? So I had to research, and the reason why is because collard greens is high in potassium, and potassium is too much for the heart. And for you to do dialysis, your heart cannot be fed with more stuff that's healthy for you.
Right.
So I had to find a binder to bind up that potassium. And so strawberries is a binder for potassium. So I said, instead of adding sugar to the collard greens, how about we saute some strawberries with a little bit of sugar and pour it right on top? Abasha. And so the red and the green, it just look beautiful with the sauteed strawberries on top. Abasha. And it just look good and it tastes good all together.
Wow. Visually, it looks very pretty,
yeah.
The colors.
Yeah.
And I bet it tastes
amazing.
Amazing. Wow. So you've got all these things that's happened in your life. You've got great things happening for you now, and future is very, very bright. Possibly a book, possibly a catering kitchen. Is there anything else that you actually envision for yourself that you want to make happen next?
Well, I do currently have my Chef Bougie Rub. I am known as the Bougie Chef, so I call it Chef Bougie Rub. It's great on proteins. I've heard it's good on eggs. You know, people buy it. And so that's out now. Future endeavors, I want to put together a brunch that's open to the public, because all of my events are private because people hired me privately to do it. So I want to do something open to Orlando. I've been here for 5 years now this month, and I think I've built up a good enough name and a brand here where I can sell tickets and do a brunch. So I was going to do Mother's Day, but that's too much around the corner. So maybe something in between Mother's Day and Father's Day, I'll do a brunch just because. It'll be like the bougie brunch.
I love it. I better get an invitation.
Yes!
Definitely. We will be there.
Yes!
We'll be there. Are you going to have collard greens and strawberries?
That's a thought.
That's a very good thought. Oh, even if it's not for the other people.
Just right.
I'm just saying.
Yes.
But I think that would be awesome because I think that, you know, everybody would, I'm sure, would love to experience you. And I mean, even though your business has blossomed, but
Yes, that's why I want to do it.
It can keep on growing,
right.
And
right.
More and more people know about you. And
exactly.
You know, that's the wonderful thing about business.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
And it's bougie robe. Now, how do
yes.
they get the bougie robe?
You own my website, or you go to the cart, the what do they call it, the View Shop on Instagram, but it still leads you back to my website. Just on my website, Chef
Juvon. Okay. And tell us your website.
Chefjuvon.com.
Aha. Get the bougie rub. Now I got to get the bougie rub.
Yes.
Now.
Oh my God. It's low in sodium. It has espresso. It has brown sugar.
Oh, it has
sugar.
Espresso.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's going to give you a little energy?
Yeah, a little bit. Just a little bit of something. Brown sugar, garlic, some, you know, your basic spices, and it has some secret spice in
there. Yeah, of course.
But it's low in sodium, so
I
that,
like that
you can use more of it. When I say rub, it's like you can take a gulp of it and put it on your meat, and it won't downplay it by sodium.
Right.
So it's good enough for that.
Yeah, and that's very important because, you know, high blood pressure.
Correct.
It's you know, a killer. So
right.
low on sodium sounds amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And the espresso, I'm just intrigued on the espresso part, though, you know.
Man.
So I'm going to have to get some of this bougie. See, I'm looking for samples. Didn't nobody bring me anything today. They don't love me.
I'm going to get on my marketing person. She was supposed to assemble some bougie rolls for me, and she did not.
Oh, we gonna get on that person. Yes, we are on you.
She makes my tumblers too.
So we will be looking for some bougie rub.
Yes.
You can drop it off, you can mail it, you know, we can figure all that out. But anyway, it has been delightful. I learned a lot, because things that we see and hear, we take for granted.
Absolutely.
And until you experience it, or you're close to somebody that has experienced it,
mm-hmm.
you really don't know.
People take it granted for life. People take for granted that you're able to sit up, you're able to clap. Some people can't even clap. Some people lost their pinky. And you don't realize how important that pinky is until you lose it. Do you want to wait until you lose that?
No.
No. Appreciate life.
Absolutely.
The ability to go to the bathroom to urinate? Can you imagine not being able to do that?
No.
I did. 5 years I wasn't able to urinate.
Oh, really?
Nothing.
I didn't know that was part of dialysis.
Oh, you have no kidney to filter it.
Oh.
So first the liquid goes down, it filters the granulites in the kidney, grabs all the nutrients that your body needs, then kicks out the rest of the nutrients into
right.
your bladder,
right.
and that's where your bladder pushes out, when it gets to a certain level, pushes out through the urethra, then it goes through vaginal.
Right.
Your penis or
whatever you got.
Yeah. Whatever.
What about the part you have? That's where it comes
from. Your urethra.
Yeah.
And that's when you void.
But if you're on dialysis, you don't.
You don't.
Interesting.
So
is that something you had to relearn, though? Once you had the transplant, did you have to kind of relearn
no,
how to
I didn't
happen?
Have to relearn it. My body had not. It didn't have to relearn it. Like, I just got a friend that just had a transplant, literally, like, last week, and he hit me up. He said, man, usual, he used another word, that you go to the bathroom so frequent? I said, well, yeah, because now something else just got added, and now the fluid gets to go somewhere, and so
right.
your body's like, oh, we got a kidney now!
We're working.
Yeah.
We're all
so
in this together.
He's going to the bathroom constantly. I said, well, praise God, because 15 years he was on dialysis.
Wow.
And he wasn't able to urinate.
15 years. Now, is that somebody you met during that time?
No,
or
this is an old friend of mine.
Wow.
And there's so many things, like, when you're on dialysis, you have a diet restriction. Now, if you can't urinate, where's the fluid going?
Right.
It's going in your body.
Body. Yeah.
Right? So now they're saying, not now, but when you're on dialysis, you go only drink so much fluid per day.
Oh, because it can't go with
it. It won't go with it. So can you imagine, this is all the water you can drink for today. Just this one bottle. That's it. That includes rice, that includes Jell-O, anything that uses to cook.
That has water in it.
Right.
So if you had coffee, we probably couldn't do coffee, could you?
No, you cannot do coffee. Anything that's dark for your kidneys is not good for your kidneys.
Okay. So
even
no
now.
Tea, no nothing.
Even now. But this is all you can drink.
Okay.
That's
otherwise
it.
It's going to flow up.
It's
going to
get in your muscle. It's going to swell. It's going to get into your lungs. You can drown. You can. It gets into your face. It gets into your legs. And it seeps where it's not supposed to go.
Right.
So for 15 years, he was on dialysis.
That's a long time.
That's a long time to be tugging on your heart. And that's why people die on dialysis, because the machine is pulling against the pumping, the love dub. It's pulling against the love dub of your heart. And so that's why it damages. It's like me tugging on your arm for 15 years. Your arm's gonna get tired, the muscles are going weak.
Right.
And that's what the machine does for the heart.
Wow, that is amazing. I'm telling you, so you know what that says to me? If you know somebody that's on dialysis, hopefully you have a better understanding mm-hmm. of what they're really going through, mm-hmm. because that's not easy, mm-hmm. you know, and not knowing when and mm-hmm. if you're going to get a transplant or if this is going to be your life until whenever. So, you know, sometimes we take for granted a lot of things. Then they say, oh, they're just doing this, or they're just doing it, they'll just be fine. And you know, we got to be a little more empathetic.
Yes.
I'm more empathetic now because now I have a better understanding. Mm-hmm. I was sympathetic before because I'd say, oh, that's sad. Right. I'm sorry you're going through that. But right. now I have a totally different level because it's a lot deeper than I thought. You know, I was very surface level.
Right.
So
right.
I know you got a lot of education today about yes. that. But I hope you also got an education as far as take care of your health. Listen to your body.
Yes.
Because it will tell you.
It does.
It tells you. And you wasn't listening. You was listening. Saying, shut up. Yes. Shut up. Shut yes. up.
Let's try to suppress. I tell people that all the time. When you get a headache, you ain't just getting a headache just to be getting a headache. Your body is communicating with the cerebral, the head part of the body.
Right.
It channels back to here. And the headache says to you, it says, hey, Juvon, something is going on. You need to get it checked out. That's what headache's for. Don't undermine headaches. That is, they're signaling. When you get a temperature, your body's trying to fight something.
Absolutely.
It's not minute. Something is going on.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
This is Donate Life Month. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for a transplant. I'd probably be dead.
Oh, this is Donate Life Month?
April is Donate Life Month.
Really?
You can give 12 people another life if you was to be on a donate list. This is my property commercial. 12 people you can give a new life to. Eyes, fecal kidney, liver, heart, lung, it goes on and on. 12 people, if you put yourself on a donor's list, and just let it be on your license. You ain't going to heaven with it or hell with it. Just donate. That was a commercial.
And that is a commercial. But you know what? That is so true because I was at... I can't think of her name. She's a well-known singer up in Gainesville. Her daughter needed a transplant, so she's been going through this, and then she was on the donor, and they had the people come out that talk about that, and they gave the brochure, and when I showed all the body parts that mm-hmm. you can...
12.
Yeah, 12 I was transplant. Amazed. Yeah. I was like, wow, you know? Yeah. Like you said, we really can't use it after that.
Right.
So if you can help somebody else live, see, you know, function.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm. Why not?
So, why not, right? So I'm sure that's on your license, right?
I can't be a donor.
Oh, because you're... Really? Is that yeah, so? Yeah. So they won't take your eye? Nothing.
No. I mean, I don't know why, but that's what they said.
Huh. That's funny. Like, I can't get you nothing else. But
anyway. That's true, though. I need to check into that.
Yeah. I mean, that just seems kind of interesting.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's a good thing to think about. And it has been a pleasure. So pleasure if so you much. Need a celebrity chef, now, just don't be talking about price now, but if you need a celebrity chef, you want good food personality, you know, relationship, great event, check him out. This is your celebrity chef.
You know what I want to say? A lot of people think when they hear celebrity chef that I cost like so much money. I mean, I'm not the best price in town. I'm not. But if you can go to the Gucci store, right. if you can go to T-Mobile or Sprint, right. well, there's no more Sprint. If you can go to these companies and buy a brand new phone.
Oh, yeah.
That means you know what you want. You like luxury. You like to see what you have. You know what you want. Why not pay for that chef? Another commercial.
Absolutely, because for events, yes. you know, when you have an event, yes. you know, everybody has all kinds of events, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And you just make it a great event.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just take.
Why cook? Just sit back and relax. Let Juvon handle it. Chef Juvon. ChefJuvon.com. It's your boy. We out of here.
Yeah, and don't forget, you got to get your what?
Chef Bougie Rub. Yes, you got to get bougie with us. Because when you get that Chef Bougie Rub, your pinky steaks out. It makes you bougie. Yes!
It has been a pleasure. Yes. And I'm going to be looking for that little gift package in a little bit. I know you guys were inspired, encouraged, uplifted, and informed and educated today. So on that note, love ya. Till next time.
Have a TV show idea, but don't know how to get started? Reach out to me at glstvnetwork.com@gmail.com. Again, that's glstvnetwork.com@gmail.com. And we'll help you find your voice.